In today's world with the media, TV, movies, music, books, magazines, and the internet, there's a lot of information readily available to the public. For years and centuries, blacks have learned all about history through a European influence. It has influenced the black Christian church, and has influenced all races in America to develop stereotypes on the black race. Most people are conditioned to believe everything they are told by their parents, school teachers, pastors, and also their friends. We're also programmed to believe everything we see on TV. But what if everything we've been told is a lie? What if our history is a lie, or a half lie, or a half truth? What happens when we get tired of hearing, well, that's the way it is, and that's all we know, or let's just move on to the next subject or chapter? What happens when we start to wake up and demand answers to all of these unanswered questions? Satan and the powers of this world do not want us to wake up. America does not want an informed people, especially an informed black race. What's even worse is that they do not want an informed, educated, fed up, and unified black race. In this DVD documentary series, I'm going to go into depth, revealing our history using biblical facts and historical actual facts from many, many years ago. I'm going to expose some of the lies we have been fed and uncover the truth. Once I explain our history, I'm going to correlate it to how it's affecting us, meaning the black race, right now, today, in America, and even the world. You will begin to wonder and say, I wasn't crazy after all, and it has to be a reason as to why blacks have been suffering for what seems to be an eternity. Hopefully, after I connect all the dots, exposing all the lies, deceit, and agendas that Satan has used to destroy blacks using other races, you will finally see how it all makes sense. Someone once quoted, "A lie cannot live forever." Well, this person was correct. So get ready to have the very foundation of what you've been taught all these years shaken by the truth. After you've seen and heard what I have to show, I guarantee that the way you think will never be the same. The truth shall set us free.
All right, so this is the presentation, Last Days, Hebrews to Negroes. Now, this presentation is much needed today. A lot of people, they are basically, how to say it, in darkness. A lot of people are asleep to what's going on behind the scenes. And a lot of stuff we've been taught as children, we just take that and run it as this as truth, but it's a lot more behind the scenes that's going on. A lot more in terms of the government, religion, society, education, that people don't understand, even our history and our culture as itself. So this presentation is basically going to kind of expose all the hidden truths and lies that've been going on for thousands of years. So. Basically, right now, it's time to get ready to learn the hidden truth of what's been kept from us for all these generations. This presentation is like no other presentation you have seen. Are you ready to have your mind blown? It's time to open your eyes to see things from a different perspective. All I ask is that you keep an open mind just for yourself after you have seen everything. So the question I'm asking is can you really handle the truth? A lot of people say that they can handle the truth, but they really can't handle the truth, because when you give them the truth, it just shakes their world, shakes their foundation they've been taught, and it's really hard for people to break out of that conditioning and programming that they receive from education, from their parents, and from society. But Obama says, yes, we can. Yes, we can handle the truth, so let's go. So right now, the question people need to ask themselves is, do they want to continue to have trick knowledge, or do they want the truth? So you got to choose which one you want. That's if you want to continue to be in darkness and just go with the okie doke and accept the trick knowledge, then that's fine. But it's really beneficial for everybody on this planet to know the truth. So we've done the research for you, so let's begin. So just like in the Matrix, it says that Morpheus, he says, take two pills. You either take the blue pill and the story ends and you wake up in your bed and you believe whatever you want to believe, or you could take the red pill and you can stay in Wonderland and I can show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Morpheus says in the movie, I'm only offering the truth and nothing more. And so what does Neo do? He accepts the pill that's going to take him deep and deeper into the rabbit hole as far as it goes. And fortunately, not a lot of people are taking that leap into this rabbit hole. A lot of people are just want to take the blue pill and wake up in the bed and believe whatever they want to believe. And that's basically being caught up in the matrix, as most people would say today. So Marcus Garvey, legendary pioneer, black leader, he quoted that people without their knowledge, or people without the knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture, is like a tree without roots. And one of the famous quotes by Harris Tubman is that she said that, I freed 1,000 slaves. However, I could have freed 1,000 more slaves if they only knew they were slaves. And that's very interesting because a lot of people, you know, they're living in a world, their own little box. And you try to awaken their mind and get them to think, see things from different perspectives, but they don't want to hear it. You know, they don't want to hear anything that's outside of what they've been taught. And so, in a sense, they are like the person that's been a slave so long that he doesn't even know he's a slave. He's comfortable with it, and he can't live outside of being a slave. And so, when it comes time to run away and be free, he feels like everything is all good. And the master treat me right. I'm eating, I got a family, and he feels like, nope, I'm not going anywhere. And unfortunately, that's the problem with a lot of African Americans today. We continue to be in this slave mentality. So a lot of times in the Bible, it talks about the curse of Canaan, and also talks about the curse of Israel. Now, a lot of even Africans will say, well, you know, is it the curse of Canaan, or sometimes they say Canaan? That's the reason why black people are going through what we're going through in Africa and even in America. So the question is, you know, that I'm trying to portray is, who are we? Why can't we get ahead? Why does everyone hate us? Why are we always treated unfair? Why are they trying to get rid of us? Why can't we stick together? Why is there so many obstacles preventing us from succeeding? Why does the world discriminate us based on skin color? And why do we work for everyone else? Now, Obama, he did a speech in Roanoke, Virginia in 2012. And basically, Obama's telling us here, and this is what he quoted, if you've been successful, you didn't get there on your own. You didn't get there on your own. I'm always struck by people who think, well, it must be because I was just so smart. There are a lot of smart people out there. It must be because I worked harder than everybody else. But let me tell you something. There are a whole bunch of hardworking people out there. Now, Obama says that if you were successful, somebody along the line gave you some help. There was a great teacher somewhere in your life. Somebody helped to create this unbelievable American system that we have allowed you to thrive in. Somebody invested in roads and bridges. If you got a business, you didn't build that. Somebody else made that happen. The internet didn't get invented on its own. Government research created the internet so that all the companies could make money off the internet. And this is what Obama was saying. So somebody else supposedly made all of this stuff happen. If you're successful, somebody else made that happen. But who is that somebody else? Is it God, or is it the government, or is it some other entity? So in our dollar bill says that in God we trust. But God can mean a lot of things. God can mean Baal, it could be Moloch, it could be Dagon, it could be Ishtar, it could be Yahweh, it could be Jesus, it could be Jehovah, it could be Allah, it could be whatever you want it to be. So the question is, why can't I be successful? And more importantly, what God are we trusting in? Are we trusting in the government or the God of the Old and New Testament or whatever your God may be? Now, the hardships the ancient Hebrew Israelites experienced over many centuries parallel the hardships people of African descent have gone through since the beginning of the Common Era, or AD, as most people would know it as. Is this a coincidence? No, it's not a coincidence. So in the Bible, in Deuteronomy 28, 45, verses 45 to 46, it says, and this is a very important verse that a lot of people don't really pay attention to. It says, moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou hearkens not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which he commanded thee. And this is the last verse that people really need to pay attention to. It says, and they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder and upon thy seed forever. Now, the last time I checked in the Bible, forever meant forever, meaning that if God's going to reign forever and ever, then that's forever. It doesn't mean that it's going to stop, you know, at the destruction of the first temple or the second temple. And these curses were not supposed to stop when Jesus came and he died on the cross and was ascending into heaven in the Christian religion. Now, most people are tricked today to believe that the white European Jews of today are descendants of the ancient Hebrew Israelites and the 12 tribes of Israel. Sadly, they are incorrect. This information has been hidden from us for a reason that's very, 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 very deep and disturbing. Now, there was a man named Cornelius Tacitus, and he lived in 56 AD, around 117 AD. He was a senator and a historian of the Roman Empire. And he had a book, and the book he wrote was called The Annuals and Histories of Tacitus. And he quoted in this book, and this is about 2,000 years ago, or a little less than 2,000 years ago, he quoted that many assert that the Hebrews are a race of Ethiopian origins. So when you think of that, you say, I said, well, the Hebrews, are they talking about the Ethiopian Hebrews that's in Israel right now? No, because back then, Ethiopia or Cush represented and meant a lot of things. And the land of Cush or Ethiopia was far more greater and bigger than what the current size of Ethiopia and Africa is right now. And I'll explain later. Now, this is a map of the Africa in the 1600s. And back then, the Atlantic Ocean near the west coast of Africa, near Benin and Togo and Nigeria and Ghana, was called the Oceanus Ethiopicus. So it's essentially like the Ethiopian Ocean. And here we have this other map. You see another map of Africa. And as you can see, they section out Africa into Lower Ethiopia, Upper Ethiopia, Nubia, and then you have Egypt, and then you have the Sahara Desert. Of course, everything below the Sahara Desert, or Sub-Saharan Desert, is most of the true African states. Nowadays, above the Saharan Desert, you have the North African Arab states that most of the Arabs are currently living, like Egypt and Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco. Back then, in those days, ancient days, you had Lower Egypt, which was closer to the Mediterranean Sea, and then you had Upper Egypt, which is closer to Nubia, which was also basically a part of Sudan and parts of Ethiopia. Now, here we have a slide of the Ethiopian Nubians, and as you can see, they were dark-skinned people with earrings, just similar to Africans in Africa and African Americans today, even people in the Caribbean, Jamaica, Haiti, and Antigua and Trinidad. And the Bible, it talks about how the Israelite women and men used to dress. And here we have a picture of a Nubian sister, African, wearing earrings, and she's wearing nose earrings, and she's wearing earrings in her ears, she's wearing headbands and a necklace. And in Isaiah chapter 3, verse 20 to 21, it says, the bonnets and the ornaments of the legs and the headbands and the tablets and the earrings, the rings and nose jewels. So right there, they're telling you that the ancient Hebrew Israelite women, they wore nose jewels, nose earrings. They had earrings. They also had headbands and ornaments of the legs. Now, even to this day in Africa, you will see Africans and even African Americans with nose earrings and headbands and and necklaces and bracelets and even leg bracelets. And these are all from, you know, the culture of Hebrew tradition. Even the Indians, even also another race of people that also have wear earrings and nose jewels and headbands. And they're also people of color. Now, this is just showing some ancient history. Back then, there was a pharaoh, and excuse my pronunciation. A lot of these ancient words are pronounced different ways. But there was a man named Taharqa, and he was a pharaoh of the ancient Egyptian 25th dynasty from 690 BC to 664 BC. And he was also the king of the kingdom of Kush in Nubia, which was located in northern Sudan. He reigned in the Egyptian 25th dynasty as pharaoh of Egypt. And as you can see here on the slides, he's definitely a black man. With the wide nose and the full lips and the brown skin. And here we have another slide of Pharaoh Taharqa, founder of the Kushite Empire. And you could spell Kush with a K, with a C. Here's another picture of King Taharqa representing the Sphinx, just like in Egypt, with the snake. Here we have a picture of the Sphinx at Luxor, Egypt. And as you can see, here's some more pictures of the Sphinx, just like the King of Nubia had. And as you can see in the background, you see the obelisk, which is, I'll explain that later in the slide. And here we have another king of Kush, Nubia, King Kashta. And King Kashta, as you can see at this slide, he's a black man. And he has the same crown and headdress as the ancient Egyptians, with the snake right above the temple, right above the forehead, above the nose, just like King Tut of Egypt over here to the right. And it's amazing how everybody thinks of the Egyptians and the pharaohs are wearing these crowns with the snakes in the at the top of the head, but they were also doing it in Ethiopia and Kush and Nubia too as well. Now, there's a fact that there are more pyramids in Ethiopia, Sudan area, 223 in total, than there are in Egypt. So who influenced the pyramids all over the world? Because there's pyramids, you know, in South America, there's pyramids in, you know, in China, they reported, there's pyramids in Egypt and Sudan and in a lot of different places, there's pyramid type structures. So here we have on this slide, you have the pyramids of Meroe, ancient Kush, Sudan / ancient Ethiopia. And then you see over here, pyramids of Giza, ancient Egypt. This slide right here, we see the obelisk in Axum, Ethiopia. And you also see it in Luxor, Egypt. Now, the obelisk, basically today in America, is the Washington Monument. And Washington Monument, if you go there and you take a ride all the way to the top in the elevator, you'll see a lot of Egyptian religious writings and symbolism inside of the elevator. And this also sits in St. Peter Square in Vatican City. London City, it sits in Brazil, it sits in Israel, near the Israeli Supreme Court. It also is in Egypt, it's in Sudan, Ethiopia. So these obelisks are in a lot of places, and it talks about these obelisks in the Bible, which I'll explain later. So the question is, what was Ethiopia? Back then, the modern geographic name Ethiopia was confined to the country known as Abyssinia, an extensive territory in East Africa. In ancient times, Ethiopia extended over vast domains in both Africa and Asia. Now, there's a man named Sir E.A. Wallace Budge, and he said that it seems certain that classical historians and geographers called the whole region from India to Egypt, both countries inclusive, by the name of Ethiopia, and in consequence, they regarded all dark-skinned and black peoples who inhabited it as Ethiopians. In addition, he said that Homer and Herodotus call all the peoples of Sudan, Egypt, Arabia, Palestine, and Western Asia and India Ethiopians. Strabo was a Greek historian who lived 63 BC to 21 AD. And he himself quoted that, "I assert that the ancient Greeks, in the same way as they classified all the northern nations which they were familiar as Scythians, so I affirm they designated as Ethiopia the whole of the southern countries toward the ocean." Now, Strabo adds that if the moderns have confined the appellation Ethiopians to those only who dwell near Egypt, this must not be allowed to interfere with the meaning of the ancients. Another Greek historian named Ephorus, he lived around 400 BC to 330 BC. This is a long time ago. He said that the Ethiopians were considered as occupying all the south coast of both Asia and Africa, and adds that this is an ancient opinion of the Greeks. Now, Stephanus of Byzantium, Greek 6th century AD writer, wrote that Ethiopia was the first established country on earth, and the Ethiopians were the first who introduced the worship of the gods, who established laws. And the vestiges of this early civilization have been found in Nubia, the Egyptian Sudan, West Africa, Egypt, India, Persia, Mesopotamia, Arabia, South America, Central America, Mexico, and the United States, and Mashonaland. And right here is ample evidence if anybody wants to read any books about this. Now, in Lucian was also an ancient writer, lived in the 1800s. He wrote a book of astrology. He declared that the Ethiopians were the first people that invented the science of the stars, gave names to the planets, not at random and without meaning, but descriptive of the qualities which they conceived them to possess. And it was from them that this art was passed, still in a perfect state, to the Egyptians. So, another Greek philosopher, Proclus, lived in 412 AD. He quoted that, "We find the great nations of the world, both past and present, worshiping black gods. Then we logically conclude that these peoples are either members of the black race, or that they originally received their religion in part from black people." Now, back in the day, the ancient Canaanites, Phoenicians, they worshiped the god Baal. And if you look at ancient pictures of the statues of Baal, you will see that Baal is a black person. His face is dark, and you wonder, why would you worship a black person if you wasn't black yourself? It doesn't make any sense, because right now in America, we worship Jesus Christ, and they portray Jesus Christ as a white man with blue eyes and blonde hair. Now, the proofs are abundant. The ancient gods of India are also shown with Ethiopian-type crowns on their heads. And according to the Old Testament, Moses first met God during his sojourn among the Midianites, who were the Ethiopian tribe. Now, getting back to the Hebrews, to Negroes, it's recorded by many historians that in the year 65 BC, the Roman armies under General Pompey captured Jerusalem. And in 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son, Roman Emperor Titus, put an end to the Israelite state with great slaughter. During the period of the military governors of Palestine, many outrages and atrocities were committed against the residue of the people. And during the period from Roman General Pompey to Roman General Julius Caesar, it was estimated over 1 million Jews fled into Africa, fleeing from Roman persecution and slavery. It's also a known fact that the slave markets were full of black Israelite slaves. And this is in the book of Babylon to Timbuktu by Rudolf R. Windsor. Here's a slide picture of Roman Emperor Titus when Vespasian was declared emperor on July 1st, 69 AD. His son Titus was left in charge of ending the Jewish rebellion. And in 70 AD, he besieged and captured Jerusalem and destroyed the city and the Second Temple of Solomon. Now, after that, and throughout time, before that, the Hebrew Israelites had escaped persecution and captivity and being killed by fleeing into where else but not other than Africa and Arabia. And from Arabia, it went down into the bottom parts of Arabia, Yemen, where Yemen and Qatar are Oman right now. And a lot of times they crossed over the Red Sea over into Ethiopia, and they either traveled across Africa to West Africa, or they traveled down to South Africa. And from Africa, of course, as many people know it, the slave trade market took Africans or Hebrew Israelites dwelling in Africa, and they were black themselves, all across the world to be scattered into all the nations. Now, we, as African Americans and even blacks living in Jamaica and Brazil and Suriname and Guyana and Haiti and Dominican Republic, we describe ourselves as being from that land. I'm Haitian, I'm Dominican Republic, I'm Dominican, I'm from Brazil, I'm Cuban, I'm African American, but we really don't know who we really are. You know, all we know is that we are descendants from Africa, but in Africa there are a lot of different people. There were a lot of different descendants of Cush and Mizraim and Put and Canaan and also the Hebrew Israelites. But the Bible says that Deuteronomy 32, verse 26, that it says that God will scatter the Israelites. Now it says here, I said I would scatter them, the Israelites, into the corners of the earth. In parentheses, I would make the remembrance of them to cease among men. Psalms 83, 4 says, they have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. In Jeremiah 17, 4 says, and thou, even thyself, shalt discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in a land which thou knowest not. For ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, and which shall burn forever. Now, in these three verses, it's saying that God's gonna scatter the Israelites into the corners of the earth. He was gonna make them lose their heritage, and he was gonna make the remembrance of them to cease among all men. And that the name of Israel, or the Hebrew Israelites, would be no more in remembrance. That's interesting. So, as we go forward, you'll see why I'm emphasizing these three scriptures. So, the question is, if it's documented over 1 million remaining Israelites fled into Africa to escape Roman persecution, and if it says in Deuteronomy that the children of Israel and their seed shall endure the curses forever for not keeping God's commandment, then who is in Israel right now? And also, how can the white European Jews of today be descendants of God's children of Israel when it's a known fact that they participated in the transatlantic slave trade? Now, if they are truly God's chosen people, they, like others, are guilty of keeping God's commandments. Therefore, they should still be going through the curses listed in Deuteronomy 28, verses 15 through 68. Now, the scriptures also say that the Israelites will be led into captivity and scattered across the world. But how can this be correct if the so-called white Europeans called Jews were the ones that were taking slaves into captivity all across the world on the slave ships? So, you know that one cannot be a slave and also a slave master. So you can't be scattered as a slave into the four corners of the earth, but be the one that's the slave master that's taking the slaves there. You got to be one or the other. And also, just as two white European Jews cannot produce a black Jew, the ancient Hebrew Israelites in the beginning had to be either black or white. So, who is going around saying that they are Jews when they are not? Or better yet, the big question is, what is a Jew? This is a big difference. Now, back then they were called the Hebrew Israelites, children of Israel. If you were from the tribe of Dan, you were a Danite. If you were from the tribe of Judah, you were a Yehudaite. If you were from the tribe of Benjamin, you was a Benjaminite. If you was from the tribe of Levi, you was a Levite, and so on. Back then, that they didn't call themselves Jews. And back then, in Old Testament days, at least way back, Judaism didn't exist, so they could not be a person called a Jew, because there wasn't no Judaism to call somebody a Jew. Because as you will see later, the word Jew is basically anybody that follows the practices of the religion of Judaism. And it has nothing to do with being a descendant of the 12 children of Israel, which in the Bible are God's chosen people. So the Bible talks about the synagogue of Satan. Jesus talks about it himself in Revelations 2:9. But who was he referring to? And, you know, what is a Jew? It says in Revelations that 2:9, it says, I know thy works in tribulation and poverty. But in parentheses, it says, but thou art rich. Well, we know that in today's time, black people are not rich. You know, we're at the bottom of the wealth gap. You know, and you know, follow above us would be probably Latinos in America. And it says also, and I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Revelations 3:9 says again, behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not. So in the Bible, Jesus always referred to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes as a generation of vipers, a seed of the serpent. John the Baptist even said the same thing. Whenever he saw the Pharisees and the Sadducees coming, he would call them generation of vipers, seed of the serpent. And the Sadducees and the Pharisees were the ones that helped found the Babylonian Judaism, which Jesus despised. Same people that crucified him. So what race of nation of people would knowingly call themselves Jews when they are not? Well, it's not black people. It's not the Arabs. It's not Asians. It's not Latinos. It's not Indians. So the only people that's call themselves Jews right now, the European Jews. But has the world been tricked to believe that the white Europeans are Jews and are thus God's chosen people? Because, of course, they label Jesus Christ as a Jew when Jesus was from the tribe of Judah. And Jesus Christ did not practice Judaism. We will soon see who has been lying for all these years. Because as you will know, and you'll see later, that anybody back then in those times that converted to Judaism, whether you were Roman or Greek, or whether you were from Assyria, whether you were Edomite like King Herod, you were labeled a Jew. You practiced circumcision. And so the word Jew is misleading when people think about it. But we've been taught to believe that the Jews are God's chosen people in the black Christian church. Now, let's see who hasn't been keeping God's commandments. Because, of course, based on the Bible, if the children of Israel didn't keep his commandments, then they were supposed to have these curses forever. And so, in Judaism, Judaism rejects Jesus Christ as Messiah and God. This is in Exodus 20, verse 3. The European Jews killed and murdered thousands of black slaves during the transatlantic slave trade and during slavery. This is a violation of Exodus 20, verse 13. The European Jews committed adultery with the African female slaves, both young and old. This is in Exodus 20, verse 14. The European Jews did, in fact, steal Africans or Hebrew Israelites from their land to be forced into inhumane slavery. Of course, Ten Commandments says, thou shalt not steal. And the European Jewish slave masters did, in fact, bear false witness, which means lie, against the slaves repeatedly. This is why a lot of them were killed, just off of basic, simple allegations that they had were in the house, or they tried to talk to one of the white women in the plantation house, or if they supposedly were accused of having sexual relations with a white person, they were, you know, whether they did it or not, they were hung and beat and killed. And the European Jewish slave masters did, in fact, covet the African male slaves, their wives. And the European Jews also helped manipulate the words of the Bible, which goes against Deuteronomy 4:2, Revelation 22:19, and Proverbs 30, verse 5 2:6. Most notably, they placed God's name with Lord, and they also labeled Jesus as King of the Jews, and also added and hid different books from different biblical canons of different nationalities. That's why everybody's Bibles have different number of books in it. The Catholic Bible, the Greek Bible, the Ethiopian Coptic Bible, the King James Bible, the Catholic Church Bible. All these Bibles have different number of books, and you ask, well, how do I know I'm getting the word inspired by God if things were kept out of this book and put in this book? So we have to look into that. So the question is, if the European Jews are God's chosen people, then why aren't all the 12 tribes of Israel in the Holy Land right now? And how come they don't possess the Ark of the Covenant? How come God allows them to have gay pride parades every year for the last 15 years in Jerusalem? How come God allows three major religions to worship their gods in Jerusalem, the Catholic Church, Islam, and Judaism? How come the land and borders that modern-day Israel possesses now is much smaller than biblical borders that were promised to Moses by God in Numbers 34, verses 1 through 3? It is also smaller than the territory that was occupied by King David and King Solomon. And we know that God does not do things halfway. And shouldn't there be more black Israelites in Israel, knowing that the Israelites, who many attest were black themselves, intermarried with the ancient Egyptians, Ethiopians, Canaanites, and Libyans for thousands of years? And more importantly, who are they preparing to build the third temple in Jerusalem for when in Revelation 21, verses 1 to 2, it says that a new Jerusalem is seen coming out of heaven for God to sit on the throne? So who is going to sit on this throne in this man-made Jewish temple? It's a big question people need to really pay attention to. So during Jesus' time, most of the children of Israel were already scattered and lost part of scriptures from their different run-ins with captivity and slavery and exile from the Egyptians, from the Assyrians, from the Babylonians, from the Persians, from the Greeks, the Romans. So after the destruction of Solomon's Temple in 70 AD, the last of the real Hebrews had already been scattered into neighboring countries like Africa and Arabia. However, back then, the face of Africa and Arabia was different because the Arab Islamic Empire didn't even conquer these areas until 600 AD. But Jesus himself predicted that the Israelites would be taken as slaves and scattered into all nations. He called the people who would possess Jerusalem afterwards Gentiles. Now, in the black church, we always taught that we are Gentiles. Latinos are Gentiles. Everybody's a Gentile except for the Jews that we see walking around in America and in Israel and all over the world. In Ezekiel 39:23, says that the heathen, which is all the nations that are not Israelites, shall know that the house of Israel went into captivity, which is slavery, for their iniquity, because they trespassed against me. Therefore, I hid my face from them and gave them into the land, into the hand of their enemies, so that they fell by the sword. So in Luke 21:24, this is Jesus' words himself, and it's in red, just like in the Bible, and it says, and they, the Israelites, shall fall by the edge of the sword. Back then, they didn't have guns. And shall be led away captive into all nations. That's very important, because when it says to be led away captive, it means led away as a slave, but it says into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down, which means taken over, of the Gentiles. Gentiles are those who are not Israelites, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So when is the Gentiles' time of fulfillment? It's a big question. Nobody pays attention to this. If you look, go further, in Luke 21, 25, 27, Jesus explains it. He says, in these times, there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, and the sea and the waves roaring, men's heart failing them with fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the power of heaven shall be shaken. And here comes the shaker. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, folks, when you look at this last verse, it says that when these signs in the sun, the moon, the stars, the waves of the sea, people are going to be scared. The earth is going to be shaken, and then the Son of Man is going to come. This is the second coming of Christ. So, according to the scripture that that Jesus is talking about and prophesying, is that the Gentiles are still supposed to be in Jerusalem even until this day. Because as we know, the second coming of Christ has not happened yet. So, if Jesus is saying this, that when he returns for the second coming, it's going to be the time the Gentiles will be judged and taken care of, who is in Israel now? Because right now we know that the Palestinians and the Gentile European Jews are in there right now. Now, there's a man named Ben Amin. He's a leader of the Black Hebrew Israelites. They're over in Israel right now, South Israel. And he quoted that the greatest conspiracy ever conceived in the minds of men was the creation of the national homeland for Jewish people. And he claimed that Africans, African Americans, and blacks are scattered all across the world by slavery, are the victims of a cruel plot to control us, and an international religious plot that has come about as a result of black Hebrew Israelites just disobeying the law and the commandments of God. Now, the enslavement of Africans by the slave trades is seen as punishment for straying from the religious path. And he also claims that the Palestinian Arab population are not descendants of Ishmael. Ishmael, as we're taught that the Arabs are descendants of Ishmael through Abraham. But wait a minute, people need to read their Bible, because it says in the Bible that Abraham's maidservant, she was Hagar the Egyptian. And if anybody knows, back then in BC times, the Egyptians were black people with woolly hair. And they would have a child, and that child would be named Ishmael. And then it says in the Bible also that Ishmael's own mother, Hagar the Egyptian, would find him a wife from Egypt. This means that the 12 princes, the 12 sons of Ishmael, would be 3/4 black Egyptian and 1/4 Hebrew. And back in those days, the Hebrews were black, so they would essentially be black. But the Arabs of today are not black. They're more skin color is more like Caucasians and Europeans than they are black. Now, he also mentioned that our studies and experience have shown that the present day inhabitants of this region are not the original people of the land. The majority of those today defined by modern historians of Arabs are veritably the descendants of the Greeks, Romans, Western, Northern European crusaders. And a lot of Arabs will tell you themselves that the reason why that their skin is white, and that sometimes they call themselves Caucasian Arabs, and that some people mistake them for Europeans in America, is that they have European blood. A lot of them do. A whole lot of them do. It's the reason why they're in desert countries, and it's 90 degrees, 100 degrees, and yet they do not get a tan. And we all know that people of color, people with melanin, can get tan. Even a lightest African American can spend one day on the beach in Miami and go back to the hotel and look at his face and see that he's gotten darker. That's just one day. One day in the weather in America. So, we need to think about this thing. So, then the Bible says that, of course, we talked about the Israelites being kicked out of Jerusalem, led in captivity. But how did they get there? Joseph and his brothers walked into Egypt 70 souls deep before later being enslaved by Egyptians. You can still walk today into Israel through Egypt, but you got to have papers and you got to scale the Egyptian-Israeli border gate, which is almost impossible to do. Back then it didn't exist. So going back to the Bible prophecy, Deuteronomy 28:68, the only way that the prophecy could come true of the Israelites being scattered into many nations, all nations, the four corners of the earth, the east, the west, the south, the north, is that they were taken there by way of ships, as stated in Deuteronomy 28:68. And this slide shows you the Israeli-Egyptian border gate, very high. The top goes in, so that means to keep people out. And you have a border, just like the Canadian-U.S. border, and you will not get into Israel unless you have papers, or you pass the test, I guess. Deuteronomy 20:68, if people you don't know it, reads that, "And the Lord will bring thee into Egypt," which means land of bondage, "again with ships." Now, in the Bible, why are we talking about ships in the Bible? Why are we talking about ships in, you know, Egypt, and Moses crossed the Red Sea, and nowhere in the Bible, really in the Old Testament, was talking about them people riding on ships. But it says, By the way whereof I spake unto thee, and thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen." Bondmen and bondwomen are slaves. "And no man shall buy you." Now we're going to explain what Egypt and this "no man shall buy you" means. So how do we know that Egypt is speaking of bondage and not the land we know now called Egypt? Because Jacob and the 70 souls, the Hebrew Israelites, they walked into Egypt. They did not go back to Egypt again by way of slavery of ships, because the Bible doesn't tell us that the Hebrew Israelites went back into Egypt for a second run of slavery. It doesn't say that. It doesn't support that. And why would God deliver his children out of the hands of the Pharaoh with all the plagues only to deliver them back into Egypt? If I was the Egyptian pharaohs, I would say, "We don't want them back no more, because, you know, you guys and your God destroyed our country." So, and even under the captivity of the Assyrians and Babylonians, the Assyrians and Babylonians didn't put them on ships and say, "We're going to dump you back off into Egypt." So right here, you know, King James Authorized Bible is kind of misleading us. And so the captivity, speaking of us being brought, black people being brought to the many nations that were being scattered to, like the Americas, the West Indies, even the Middle East and parts of the Pacific Ocean Islands and other areas, as you will see. So in Exodus 22, it states this. It says, "I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." So Egypt is synonymous with a house of bondage. And so when it says that they won't see it no more again, and they're going to be sold into the enemies for bondmen by women, and no man shall buy thee. Now, if you pay close attention to the end of this verse, it doesn't make any sense, but yet it's in our King James Bible. King James Bible that was authorized for us to have. You know, he authorized that Bible for us to have. So I wonder if it's another version that wasn't authorized. But why would a slave be sold into his enemies for bondmen and bondwomen for nobody to buy him? So why would they put the slaves on a ship, you know, ship them over to America, and they stand there and nobody wants to buy them? That don't make any sense. So why is the word there? Because back then, in Old English, the word "buy" is meant to say save or redeem. So in reality, the verse to say "no man shall save thee" or "no man shall redeem thee." And redeem means to buy or pay off, to buy back or to clear a payment, to recover or to save. So this is basically showing you that the Hebrew Israelites are going to be scattered to four corners, and that they will be sold, and that nobody will be able to purchase their freedom back. Nobody's going to bring them right back to Africa or to Israel. And this basically is foretelling what happened to the Hebrew Israelites then, and even what's been going on with our people of African descent to this day. So it's evident that the black Hebrew Israelites were sold to slavery, that they were not saved, nor did they have their freedom bought back. But this was part of the punishment, the curse of Israel that God sent on them for not obeying his commandments for 1,000 years. Now, again, the slavery that happened with Africans, it fits the description of the curses to the T that happened during the transatlantic slave trade, the Arab slave trade, and if you want to also add in the Indian Ocean slave trade, for over 1,000 years. But the Holocaust only lasted 12 years. And the Holocaust, they were already in the land. They were already in Europe, Germany, and all the places. So they didn't have to be rounded up in on ships. They were already there. Now, this is a slide picture of some Africans on an Arab slave trip. And as you can see, the majority of them are boys, are men. Another picture we see right here of the construction blueprint of the slave ships, where they had the slaves packed like sardines, inhumane conditions. But was the slavery foretold in the Bible that was going to happen, you know, thanks to the Europeans and the Arabs and in America? Because in Obadiah says, chapter 1, verse 4, says, "Thou shalt, though thou exalt thyself as the eagle," now the symbol of America and the nations of the Europeans is and always has been the eagle. The USA, Greeks, Romans, Spanish, even Germany under Hitler used the eagle as a symbol. And then it says in Obadiah, "And thou shalt set thy nest among the stars." Now we see America, we have satellites in outer space, we land on the moon. And we also see that a lot of the Arab nation flags have a star and a moon. And that's interesting because they were the main races of people that were enslaving Africans. Or African Hebrew Israelites. So was this scripture foretelling the black Hebrew Israelites being enslaved on the Arabs, the Americans, the Europeans, the Romans, the British, the Spanish, the French, and the Portuguese? It's very interesting. As you can see on the slide here, you see many of the Arab flags, and a lot of them have stars, a moon, crescent, but the colors are pretty much the same. And as you can see, most of the Arab states are North Africa and the Middle East. Here we see the symbol of USA with the eagle, symbol of Nazi Germany with the eagle, symbol of Spain with the eagle, symbol of the Roman Empire with the eagle with two heads. So the slide right here is, talks about from Europe with love. Europe brought a lot of love to the major continents of the world, India, Africa, and the Americas. Remember, it was the Europeans that came and they colonized and dominated India. At that time, it was called British India. And when they left, they took a lot of the treasures and a lot of the historical information. They also interbreeded with the Indians. And Gandhi came and he had enough, and they retired. And then, of course, you know, the Europeans, they came and they colonized almost every state of Africa. That's why you see Africans that can speak French. They got Africans that speak Portuguese. And you got the Dutch and the Germans and the British, the French, the Spanish. It's a whole just melting pot of Europeans in Africa. And they're all having fun. And even the Arab states, but even in America, the Europeans influenced the colonization and the renaming of the lands. That's why people in Brazil, they speak Portuguese from Portugal, which is Europe. You have British Guyana and Spanish Guyana, your French Guyana. They're all speaking different languages. You have Suriname speaking Dutch, and America speaking English, British America. So these are all clues. They also colonized the Caribbeans and the British Virgin Islands. That's why a lot of the people in the Caribbean, they have accents that are similar to the British and how the British speak. Now, according to the Zondervan's Compact Bible Dictionary, it lists Ham. Ham was one of the sons of Noah. In the Bible, Ham had some sons. Noah had sons, and he had Ham, he had Shem, and he had Japheth. So it says here, the youngest son of Noah, probably born about 96 years before the flood, and one of eight persons to live throughout the flood. He became the progenitor of the dark races. But it says here, not the Negroes. Why would they say that? Why would this Bible dictionary say that Ham was the father of all dark races, but not the Negroes? But it says here he was the father of the Egyptians, the Ethiopians, the Libyans, and Canaanites, who we see today. So who are the Negroes descendants of, according to this Bible? And why would the Zondervan's Bible Dictionary say that we Negroes are not descendants of Ham? Well, we always taught that black people are descendants of Ham, because Ham means hot, burnt. Surely we're not descendants of Japheth. We're not descendants of the European, Turkish, Mongolian nations. So this only really leaves Shem as our forefather. Could that be? We got to think about that. Here you have slides, a slide of the map where Shem, Ham, and Japheth they settled in. As you can see, Shem settled in Mesopotamia, Arabia. Ham descended in Africa, even in parts of Arabia as well. And Japheth, the Gentile nations of Japheth, which is in the Bible, the first time the word Gentile is even mentioned in the Bible, discusses the Japhetic nations, the islands. But yet, we are told that black people are Gentiles. And you got to also remember the reason why you see on this slide right here that the descendants of Ham also settled in Arabia and parts of the Middle East, because Nimrod's empire, if you really do your research, his empire extended from Africa, from Kush, all the way to Arabia, to Iran, to Babylon, to Assyria. He helped build the Tower of Babel. He founded the city of Babylon. And this is all in the Bible. This is all in the Bible. And Nimrod was the son of Cush. Cush meaning black. Nimrod was a black man. And in the book of Yasher and the book of Jubilees, it says that the Nimrod and the descendants of Cush, they ruled at one point over all the sons of Noah. Here we have another slide depicting the slave trade, mainly from the Atlantic Ocean over to the Americas. How blacks have been scattered, just like Bible prophecy, all over the world. Just like it says in Luke, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led captive into all nations. So the slaves were also taken to Portugal and Spain. Back then it was called the Iberian Peninsula. And some people say that they were the first to enslave and persecute the Israelites, or the slaves, Africans, that, you know, we're taught, that lived and once ruled these nations. But people don't know that there were so-called Negroes in Europe for centuries. And this is a picture of Spain and Portugal, which really is called back then the Iberian Peninsula, and France is above. Morocco is right down there at the south part of Spain. Now here's an interesting slide right here. It says that there are a few quotes from historians concerning the Jews in Spain and Portugal. Now, the author, Waits, says that an interesting graduation of all shades down to the black is exhibited by the Jews. Now, she says in her book, quote, especially dark were the Jews of Spain and Portugal. The Portuguese Jews were very dark, says co-author J.C. Pritchard. Now, the Duchess de Abrantes, which was, she's born 1784, died 1838. She was the wife of Napoleon's ambassador to Portugal. And she said, quote herself, in 1700s, that the Jew, the Negro, and the Portuguese could be seen in a single person. And this is in a book, Nature Knows No Color Line. And it says, so dark were the Jews, especially of Portugal and southern Spain, that many whites thought that all Jews were black or dark. Many of the Jews who were banished from Portugal by John II settled in the West Indies. John Bigelow, who visited Jamaica in the 1850s, saw the descendants of these Jews and said that they were Negroid. And this is also in the book, Nature Knows the Color Line. But the mystery is, how did these black Jews become misplaced, even to this day, by a group of white Jews, European Jews, calling themselves the Sephardic Jews, as you will see further. And we gotta separate who was a Jew, meaning who was a black person practicing Judaism, versus an actual person that was from descended from the tribe of Israel. So it's been said that when the Arab slave traders took slaves from West Central Africa and dropped them off on the Iberian Peninsula, that they referred to them as the people of the book, of the Yehudi, which means the children of Israel. So when I was doing research, you know, they talk about, you know, the Arabs came and they took the slaves and they brought them to Spain and Portugal. They said, well, what do you have for us? And they said, well, you know, these people on the ship, they called themselves the Yehudi. And the people was like, Yehudi, what does that mean? And they said the Yehudi means children of Israel, people of Israel, or children of Judah. And the Arabs also referred to them during this time of the slave trade as the people of the book. And we all know that the people of the book is the people of the Bible. And it's also said that the Europeans, the Khazar, which I'll explain later, the Khazar European Judaism converts, even African tribal chiefs and Arabs participated in the selling of Hebrew slaves, as it was a big money maker back then. And the Hebrew Israelites were a black nation just as the other nations of Ham, the Ethiopians, the Egyptians, Libyans, and Canaanites. The curses of Deuteronomy 28 verses 15 to 68 foretold the Hebrews' long destiny of captivity. Even today, there are Africans who call African Americans or Negroes the people of the book. This also applies to the Hebrew Israelites that were scattered to other nations and islands of the sea. Okay, so the Arabs knew who we were back in those days, even though back in those days we weren't called African Americans or Jamaicans or Haitians or Dominicans or Brazilians. They knew back then that we were the people of the book, the people they had on the slave ships that they were taking to the Iberian Peninsula, Spain and Portugal, and to all other countries of the world by way of the Arab slave trade. They knew exactly who they were putting on the ships. Now, in the Quran, the Holy Quran, it makes evidence of this. And if you read here in the Quran, 059.014, it says that they, meaning the Hebrews, will not fight you even together, except in fortified townships or from behind the walls. Strong is their fighting spirit amongst themselves. Thou wouldst think they were united, but their hearts are divided. That is because they are a people devoid of wisdom. And just like our Bible, we have different translations, like the New International Version, the King James Version, the Standard Version. Different people also had their versions of the Quran, as you see here with the different guys, Yusuf Ali and Pikthal and Sakir. The content of the paragraph stays the same, but the words may change a little bit, just like with different versions of the Bible. And so another verse in the Quran, it says, and those of the people of the book, meaning the Hebrews, who aided them, Allah did take them down from their strongholds and cast terror into their hearts. Some that some they slew, and some they made prisoners. So right here it's saying that the Muslims, under the guidance of Allah, they took down the strongholds of the Hebrews and cast terror into their hearts. Some of them they killed, and some of them they made prisoners, which is exactly what happened during the Arab slave trade. Now, this is all around early AD, probably around 600 AD, and afterwards, when the slave trade was going on at the time. And you got to remember that the Arabs that were doing the slave trade back in those days, they were not enslaving races of white people. They were not enslaving races of white men, European men, and putting them on ships to be dropped off in parts of Europe like Spain and Portugal and the Middle East. We all know this by doing a research on the Arab slave trade. So therefore, the only people they were talking about on the slave ships, called the people of the book, had to be African descendants or people from the continent of Africa that were known as the Hebrew Israelites, and this is the reason why they call them the people of the book. Now, also in the Quran 033:27, it says, and he made you heirs of their lands, their houses, and their goods, and of a land which ye had not frequented before. And Allah has power over all things. So right here in the Quran, it says that the Arabs would take the lands of the Hebrews. They would take their houses, their goods, and this land that they had not been to before. So this is clear proof that before about 600 AD, that the Arabs, the Muslims, were not in that area. So when they started to conquer and take over North Africa and the Middle East and Arabia, these were lands that were foreign to them, that was not known to them. But in these lands, in Arabia and as well as Africa, the Hebrew Israelites, a.k.a. the people of the book, were in these lands. And according to them, in the Quran, Allah was going to give them power over the Hebrew Israelites, over the people of the book. And this is documented in the Quran. Now, back in the day, around 400 AD, there was an Italian traveler named Ludovico di Varthema. And he was one of the only, well, first non-Muslim Europeans to enter into Medina and Mecca, which is in Saudi Arabia. Back then it was just called Arabia, as a pilgrim. And he traveled throughout Egypt and Israel and Palestine and Arabia and different parts of Africa. And so he wrote a book of his own accounts of his life and where he had been to, talking to the people of the land, in his itinerary of De Ludusio de Varthema. And he published it in Rome around 1510 AD. Now, in his account, he talks about the Jews that he found in the mountains of Arabia, in the Hijaz Mountains, H-I-G-A-Z. And back then, even years before that, 600 AD, the Muslims had also fought the Jews in Arabia, and this was called the Battle of Khaybar. Sometimes it's pronounced K-H-A-Y-B-A-R or K-H-A-I-B-A-R. And during this fight, the Muslims are subdued and captured the Hebrew Israelites that were there, and they also exiled them or they enslaved them. This is proof. So in the book of Ludovico, he reads that in this one part, it says the chapter concerning a mountain inhabited by Jews. So he says, at the end of 8 days, we found a mountain which appeared to be 10 or 12 miles in circumference, in which mountain there dwell 4,000 or 5,000 Jews, who go naked and are in height 5 or 6 spans and have a feminine voice. Maybe they had a high-pitched voice. And he says here, and they are more black than any other color. He says they live entirely upon the flesh of sheep and eat nothing else. They are circumcised and confess that they are Jews. And if they can get a Moor, which in that case could be synonymous with Muslim, into their hands, they would skin him alive. Because back then in those days, the Muslims or the Moors were mortal enemies of the Hebrew Israelites, the Jews. Because Judaism and Islam, you know, was going against each other in those days too. And so it says, at the foot of the said mountain, we found a tank of water, which is water that falls from the rainy season. We loaded it up. We loaded the water on top of 16,000 camels, whereas the Jews were ill-pleased, and they went about that mountain like wild goats, and on no account would they descend into the plain, because they are mortal enemies of the Moors. Now again, in here, when they describe the word Moor, the word Moor could mean Muslim, Arab, it could be your typical Caucasian, European-looking Arab, or it could be possibly even a black Moor. But nevertheless, in this account, Ludovico, in the 1400s, goes into Arabia and to these certain mountains, and he finds 4,000 to 5,000 Jews, and he describes them as being naked, but also running around about 5 to 6 spans, in that he describes them as being more black than any other color. Now, if the Jews, the European Jews, were in Arabia at that time, and they were not black, he would have described them as being white. But instead, he made emphasis on the point that they were black. And this is in 1400 AD, a little before the transatlantic slave trade started. But you got to remember that the Arab slave trade went on from early AD, 600 AD, maybe earlier, all the way until the 21st century. And so this is clear proof that the Arabs, when they were calling the slaves on the slave ships, the people of the book, they didn't know exactly that they were a people of color and they were black, as evident and marketed by different people, especially Mr. Ludovico, the Italian traveler. Now, we got a couple of friends. They themselves work around Africans from different countries like Nigeria and Ghana. And they themselves have asked the question, well, who do you guys say we are over here in America? What do they call us? And the ones that do know, they say, well, we refer to you guys as the people of the book. You're a lost people, the children of Israel, and you don't know your heritage. And that's who you guys are. But not everybody knows this. And it's mind-blowing. Why not? Now, there were hidden clues that were given about this, but you really got to do the research. You really have to be shown this to find this out. Now, there was a French slave port named Ouida. I'm sorry for the pronunciation. Spelled Ouidah, as you can see on the slide. It was a French slave port on the west coast of Africa, used in the slave trade in the city now in modern-day Benin. Benin sits between Nigeria, Togo, and Ghana. And Ouida is hard to pronounce, and in French meant Judah. Now, why would the French and the Portuguese name a slave port Judah? Now, perhaps the slaves being sold there were actual children of Israel from the tribe of Judah, because I'm sure they didn't name the town after themselves. Now, the Portuguese, the English, the Dutch, and the French all constructed forts in the city to protect their interests in slaving. And when the Portuguese reached this town in 1580 AD, they called it Ajuda, Ajuda, which was another word for Judah. And of course, the national language of this African country now is French, while others are speaking Fon and Yoruba. And as you can see on this map here, you can see right where it's at. It's right on the coastline of the Atlantic Ocean, a little small town in Benin, between Nigeria and Ghana. As we know, also know, the slave trade also was going on through Nigeria and Ghana. Anybody can go back to these countries and they can visit the slave ports and see the shackles and the place they would hold the slaves before the ships rolled up and were ready to put them on the boat. And here's a picture, it says right here, former slave market site, entrance fee. You can go there now and probably pay some money to visit and see and sightsee the slave market. And here in Ouidah, the slaves would walk down this area to get to the sea, and it's almost like they would get ready for a big journey. And it's kind of scary because when you look at it, it's like a big pillar, and right above the pillar the painting on the pillar, you see a whole bunch of slaves with chains on their wrists behind their back, all in line to get on the ship. And this is actually in Benin right now. Here's a close-up picture. It shows the slaves standing with their arms shackled and chains all chained to each other so they can't run away. And here you see the ship in the background. And the name of this port in French was Judah. And people need to think and wake up. And yes, Africans enslaved Africans as well. The same way black Egyptians enslaved the black Hebrew Israelites and other black nations. Now, we know by looking in ancient pictures of the Egyptians on the walls, we have never, at least I've never seen the Egyptians enslaving a race of white people. I've never seen the Egyptians standing in their positions of power with a group of people doing slave work, but white in appearance. Every time you look, it's always people of color. And it's important to know because when people say that Moses is white, people and have these movies like Noah and the Son of God and all this stuff, and you see all in the Bible series, you see everybody is white. It does not make sense. It's not correct. They're basically tricking America and the world, and we're just going along with it. So even in Oman, the natives of Oman, the men in Muscat, Oman, here in the slide, it says in the 1860s, an estimated 13,000 African captives were taken to the Gulf every year, and 4,000 to 5,000 were sent to Sur in Oman. Legal slavery lasted in Saudi Arabia and Yemen until 1962. Despite over 1,000 years of slavery, millennium, and continued dominated practices of slavery by the Arabs, the Islamic world still is perceived widely as less racist, more tolerant, and welcoming of blacks than the West and United States. But nobody talks about the Arab slave trade. The Arabs started, well, they were taking slaves back in early AD, way before the transatlantic slave trade happened. And it continued for over 1,000 years. Even continues some parts of the Africa even now, in Sudan, Mauritania. It's sad that nobody really knows this. But when are we going to wake up? Remember, just because other nationalities like the Arabs and the Jews and Europeans have businesses in our communities, it does not mean that they necessarily like us or intend to help us. And you know, this is a lot of this stuff is deeply rooted. Just like there's still signs of racism and prejudicism in America today from whites versus blacks. There are also same stereotypes and prejudices from Arabs against blacks. They may not say it outwardly, but behind closed doors, it's still inbred in them from generations of generations of slavery that we underwent under the Arabs. Of course, the real reason why other races of people have businesses in our community, like Arabs and the Europeans and the Asians, is because it's to make money off of us. It's simple and plain. They are not inviting us to dinner with their families, nor are they helping to rebuild the communities that are tore down that they do business in. They could care less about our community. They care less if it's the schools shutting down. They care less if it's potholes, is holes in buildings, as long as their business is making money. They could care less what the community looks like. So, new casinos, a new Red Wings Arena, which is projected in 2016, Ford Field, Comerica Park, are not benefiting the black citizens of Detroit. It's all benefiting other people. This is why we see a majority of Detroit is going down. Education, housing, but then you see Midtown and downtown Detroit is flourishing and thriving as we speak. Here we have pictures of the slave trade, the Europeans. Also, a lot of people don't know this as well. Some Indians don't even know this, that the Dravidian Indian, dark Indian, back in the day, the original Indians are Dravidian Indians, which were the dark Indians, ones that are just as dark as black people or Africans. They were also indentured servants or slaves, and sometimes called the Dalits or the Untouchables. And they were brought to South Africa in the 1800s by way of the Dutch and Muslim slave traders. They were only identified by their number, just like in the prison system. Today, the majority of their descendants live in the city of Durban, South Africa. Back then, they were called the Cape Colored. Back in 1800s, they also were brought to the Caribbean and South America as indentured servants. They wanted to, you know, work and make money to send back to their homeland. But before that, you know, the slaves were doing all the work in these areas. But then when they freed the slaves, they said we need to still have some form of slave labor. And so they pitched the idea to the Indians that you can come over here and set up shop and, you know, like indentured servants. And they eventually was able to obtain land. And even today in modern day times, Guyana, one of the richest people in Guyana, is if you ask anybody from Guyana, is the Indians that came there, brought after the slaves were brought there. That's interesting. So let's talk about the Jews. There's two types of Jews. You have the Ashkenazi Jews and you have the Sephardic Jews. We're going to talk about the Sephardic Jews first. Not too many people know about who they are. Nowadays, Sephardic Jews are associated with Spanish Jews. So, but in the Bible, let's talk about where it all came from. Now, after the northern kingdom of Israel was conquered by the Assyrian king Shalmaneser V in 745-722 BC, the Israelites from the northern kingdom were exiled into Assyria. This is in 2 Kings 17, verses 5-7. Now, the Assyrian king then imported groups of people from his country, Assyria, to replace the exiled Israelites in order for him to maintain and control the land of the exile. So he got rid of the Israelites out of the Israel, and he told his people, come on in, you know, set up shop, we got to take over this land, nobody's here, we're going to have to, you know, keep it going. And that's what they did. And so of these people, the Sepharian people, excuse my pronunciation, were one of these groups, along with the Kuthites and the Arahites. And the word Sephardic comes from this word Sepharvim people. In 2 Kings 17:24, it reads, for all those that want to see a scripture, it says that, and the king of Assyria brought men from Babylon, which is modern-day Iraq, and from Kutha, which is modern-day Iraq, and from Ava, which is over in that area, and from Hamath, and from Sepharvaim. Sephar, you see the word Sephar, the the root, Sephar, with the Sephardic Jews, and he placed them in the cities of Samaria, which is northern Israel, instead of the children of Israel. And they possessed Samaria and dwelt in the cities thereof. So the scripture proves that the people calling themselves Sephardic Jews are not direct descendants of the children of Israel, but are descendants of the Assyrians with no real Spanish heritage, unless the people that call themselves Sephardic Jews are just people that lived in Spain and Portugal during that time and they adopted Judaism. We have to make a clear distinction, and that's kind of hard to do, but most people will say that they're descendants of these people, and this is why they are the only people that can say that they lived in the land of the Middle East with the Arabs. Now, the Assyrians, along with the other Gentile nations, mingled with each other and the Edomite people. Remember, King Herod was an Edomite. All his family was Edomites. And Edom, or Esau, was the other brother of Jacob, was the children of Israel. So these Gentile nations mingled with each other, the Babylonians, the Edomites, the Assyrians. And the Edomites, in particular, they migrated northward from Idumea, which was a field of Edom, after the 10 northern tribes of Israel were exiled during the time of the Assyrian captivity. Now, Adad and Anu were the ancient gods of Babylonia and were also the gods of these pagan Sepharvaim people. The Sephardim people, calling themselves Jews, were a Mongol people whose descent is directly a mixture of these Assyrian people group, Edomite blood, and perhaps a small remnant of the Israelites behind. This was back in thousands of years ago. The Edomites migrated into the land originally occupied by the northern kingdom of Israel, which will later be called Samaria, and also they went into the southern kingdom of Judah. So this religion, the religion of this area, also became of mixed character with diversity of people. And this is in 2 Kings 17, 24 to 41. But how do we know that the Sephardic Jews of today are descendants of the Sepharim people in BC times? Like I said, maybe they are just Spanish Portuguese blooded people who adopted Judaism. Then they associated the word Spanish or Spain and assimilated themselves to be descendants of a group of people called Jews that existed 1,000 years ago, just as the Ashkenazi Jews do to this day as well, too, and we'll explain that later. So right now, the Sephardic Jews are the term referring to descendants of Jewish settlers, supposedly originating from Israel, who lived in the Iberian Peninsula until the Spanish Inquisition. During the Spanish Inquisition, many Muslims and Jews were forced to convert to Catholicism and Christianity. The Spanish Inquisition was seen as an answer to the multi-religious nature of the Spanish society following the reconquest of the Iberian Peninsula from the Muslim Black Moors. After invading in 1711 AD, large areas of the Iberian Peninsula were ruled by Muslims until 1250, when they were restricted to Granada, which fell in 1482. Now, during the Inquisition, the Jews were persecuted and forced to Catholicism. Once this was accomplished, they were usually named Morenos, similar to the Spanish names for blacks, Morenos with an O, which was no different from being called a Negro. Now, the term Sephardic essentially has been linked now to Spanish. However, it comes from the root Sepharad, which was a biblical location from which the Sepharvaim people lived as descended, as described in 2 Kings 7:24. This location, like I said, is linked to modern-day Babylon, Iraq, but Sepharad was identified by later Jews as the Iberian Peninsula. So they're starting to just put stuff in there. But as you'll see later, I mean, it still means Spain in modern Hebrew. That's what they'll tell you. And the Sephardic Jews speak Ladino. But as you will see later, the Sephardim people were not of the children of Israel. So like I said, they were expelled in the 15th century. And this includes both the descendants of the Jews expelled from Spain under the Alhambra Decree of 1492 and for Portugal under the order of King Manuel I in 1497. And also the descendants of crypto Jews, people that are undercover Jews who left the peninsula in later centuries to the Americas, North Africa and Asia Minor and Middle East, the Philippines and elsewhere around the world. And some of them stayed in the Iberian Peninsula. So, but note, the thing to look here is that could these people be the real black Spanish Portuguese Jews We don't know. It's a lot of stuff that's been it's been changed, and history has been changed for over 1,000 years. Sources right now say that the white Sephardic European Jews make up 10 to 50% of worldwide Jewry. But the question is, where did the black Sephardic Jews that they talked about, how come they're no longer witnessed by historians after the 1400s? Moving forward, I'm showing you the picture of Edom and how the land was divided back in those days. Edom was at the bottom, and you had Kingdom of Judah and Israel, because there were two houses, the house of Israel and the house of Judah, and then you had the Moabites and the Ammonites, which was to the right. And during the time of Jesus, you still had a little remnant of Edom, or Idumea, which they called back in those days, and you had Judah. And you had the northern part of Israel, which is called Samaria, and above that you had Galilee, which is where Jesus was from, and he dwelt in the city of Nazareth. This is in Galilee. And as you can see in this slide, that Pontius Pilate and Herod Antipas, they all ruled this area, the whole Herod family, which were Edomites, if you do your research. Here's another map that shows the Herod family kingdom, extending from Edom to Judea to Samaria, all the way close to Syria and Galilee. Now, a lot of people don't know that Herod was an Edomite. So essentially, Herod was a descendant of Abraham. And he was a descendant or a cousin, or he's a relative of Jacob and children of Israel, because Jacob had a brother named Esau, and from Esau came the Edomites, and the Edomites were the Israelites' natural born enemy. But the Edomites were never sold into captivity, never experienced slavery, and Herod was an Edomite. Herod Archelaus was a son of King Herod the Great, a brother of Herod Antipas, and half-brother to Herod Philip. His mother was Maltes, and Archelaus lived from about 23 BC to about 18 AD. After the reign of his father, he became the governor of Judah, or Judea, as well as Samaria, which was also part of the ancient land of Israel, and Edom, which was also known as Idumea. Now, in the book of Matthew, it mentions this guy named Herod Archelaus in Matthew 2, verse 22, in connection with Joseph, Mary, and Jesus returning from their exile in Egypt. Now remember, God told Joseph and Mary to take Jesus to Egypt and to stay there until Herod, the ruler of Herod, died. And, again, why would God tell Mary and Joseph to flee Herod? Because Herod was trying to kill all the males, the males that were young, like 1 or 2 years old, so that he can perhaps kill the Messiah. So why would God tell Joseph and Mary to hide in Egypt if Jesus and Mary and Joseph were white? It'd be so easy to go over there and find Jesus, because he would not blend in with the Africans and the people living in Egypt. So when old man Herod died, the son Archelaus was still ruling at the time and a part of that area. So Joseph feared Archelaus and didn't want his family to be anywhere near him. So instead of settling his family in Bethlehem, which was near Jerusalem, he chose to settle in Nazareth, which is a remote town way up in the northern part of Israel and Galilee, far away from where Herod Archelaus was at. So in Matthew 2:19-22, it says, "But when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, Arise and take the young child Jesus and his mother and go into the land of Israel, for they are dead which sought the young child's life. And he arose and took the young child and his mother and came into the land of Israel. But when he heard that Herod Archelaus did reign in Judea in the room of his father Herod the Great, he was afraid to go thither." That's a known fact that there were no real boundaries between Idumea and Judea in ancient times. Now, Idumea was right below Judea, just like Ohio was right below Michigan. Idumea was close in proximity to the land given to the tribe of Judah and Simeon. During 100 BC, the Romans and Greeks were in control of Egypt and Judea in Israel. Less than 100 years after the destruction of Solomon's temple in 70 AD, John Hyrcanus I was a high priest and ruler of the Jewish nation of Judea Samaria. Now, he was a Hasmonean Maccabean, parentheses, as he was the son of Simon Maccabeus. Now, the book of Maccabees is in the Catholic Bible. It's in the Ethiopian Coptic Bible, but it's not in our King James authorized Bible. Now, I don't understand why they have seven more books than we do. I'm sure King James, he knew about these books, but he decided that, you know, we couldn't have these books. And this is also a trick. So, he was a Gentile Jewish ruler that practiced Judaism. So, John Hyrcanus was a Jewish ruler. They called him a Jewish ruler. Why? Because he practiced Judaism. But he was not of Hebrew Israelite stock. He was a Roman by blood, with Greek names given to his children because his offspring was half Greek and half Roman. His wife was Greek. His son, Aristobulus, was a Roman / Greek and assumed the power of the Hasmonean kingdom after his father's death around 105 AD. Now, if you look at his last name, Lous, most Greeks and Romans, you see the last name, you could tell that they're from Europe. And you have people, Metropolis and Opolis, you know, with the L-O-U-S on the end, you know that they are from Greece. You know that they're from Greece. So there's more even confirmation that he was not a Hebrew. He was a Greek / Roman ethnic stock that practiced Judaism. Therefore, he was called a Jew. He was the king, so they call him a Jewish ruler. So Judas Aristobulus had himself crowned king, taking the title Aristobulus I. In the single year of 104 AD that he reigned, he seized the Galilee region for Judah and compelled the inhabitants, many of whom were Syrian and Greek descent, to become Jews by converting to Judaism. But wait, there is more. Hyrcanus took also Dora and Marissa, cities of Idumea, and subdued all the Idumeans and permitted them to stay in the country, if they will only circumcise their genitals and make use of the laws of the Jews, which was Judaism. And they were so desirous of living in the country of their forefathers that they submitted to the use of circumcision and the rest of the Jewish ways of living, at which time, therefore, this befell on them, that they were hereafter called no other than Jews. So a lot of people back then in those days were called Jews because they adopted Judaism. This is a trick that they've used to cloak under the disguise that they're God's chosen people. Now, the Edomites were also Jews too. Paul even admits that Aristobulus was a Roman by expressing greetings to his household during his ministry in Rome. Remember, Paul was an apostle to the Gentiles. Paul, in the Bible, in the book of the Bible, it says apostle to the Gentiles. So Gentiles meant the European nations. Paul was where? He was in Rome. He was in Turkey. He was in Greece. So in Romans 16:10, he says, salute, which is like greetings, Apelles approved in Christ, and salute also them which are of Aristobulus' household. So he's giving greetings in Rome to Aristobulus and his household because he was of Roman Greek stock, but he was a Jew because he practiced Judaism. He was not of the children of Israel, therefore he was still a Gentile. During his reign of Judea Samaria, John Hyrcanus I forced Judaism conversion on the Edomites. They were forced to get circumcised and were called Jews. But this is all written in the book of Maccabees. It was also written by a Roman Judaism convert, Flavius Josephus, which was also a Roman, but they called him a Jewish historian because he practiced Judaism. And as you can see in a picture, you'll see that he is white and Caucasian, just like the Greeks and the Romans in that time. Now, this is very, very, very mind-blowing that I was able to come upon. And Flavius Josephus any Jewish rabbi knows who this guy is. He was an ancient Jewish writer, historian during the Roman Empire. He had access to a lot of writings, and he wrote about the Jews, and he kind of exposed who they are. And so he says here, that country is also called Judea, and the people are called Jews. And this name is given also to as many as embrace their religion. Their religion is what? Judaism. Though they be of other nations. So right then he's telling you that they are Jews because they embraced it. They embraced Judaism and they came from other nations. It didn't matter. It didn't matter where you came from. You come from India and say, I practice Judaism. Therefore, okay, you're a Jew. You live in Judea. You even double stamp with the approval that you're a Jew. Now, this is proof that the Jews in this time were simply Judaism converts from other nations like Greece and Rome. And he goes on to say that, but then upon what foundation so good as governor Hyrcanus, grandson of Matthias, patriarch of the Maccabees, a family, now this is a family of Judahite patriots of the second and first dynasties. He says that Hyrcanus took upon himself to compel these Idumeans or Edomites either to become Jews or to leave their country. Now, they said that he deserves great consideration. And he says, I suppose it was because they had long ago, the Edomites, had been driven out of the land of Edom and had seized on and possessed the tribe of Simeon. Now, he's saying that the Edomites had seized on and possessed the land, not the people of the tribe of Simeon. And they also possessed the southern part of the land of the tribe of Judah. And he says that it was a peculiar inheritance because that they were the tribe of Simeon and the tribe of Judah. They were the worshipers of the true God that didn't practice idolatry. So this is the words of Flavius Josephus. He's admitting that the Edomites had converted to Judaism, became known as Jews. They, a long time ago, left their country, were driven out their country. They went into the land of Simeon and Judah, which was the southern part of Israel, and they possessed it. And he was kind of astonished and amazed that they were able to do this, because these people that used to live in this area were actually children of Israel, and they were true worshipers of the true God.